Gravity, it's working against me. We're going to find ways that gravity can work with us. We're going to talk about gravity gradients, nature's free stabilization. The idea, here's the Earth. For a spacecraft, let's say it's elongated like this. It's a small effect, but the part that's closer to the Earth has a stronger gravitational force on it than the part that's furthest from the Earth. So if this goes a little bit sideways, there's going to be a restoring torque because the force on this is greater up here. So there's going to be a restoring torque. If this was a configuration, this is an equilibrium because the force on each side is equal. They're both equal distant from the middle of the Earth. But if you turn this a little bit, then okay, there's going to be a greater force on this than on this. This actually seems kind of destabilizing. Often you'll see satellites, they use gravity gradient, are kind of oriented this way. That's sort of the general idea. So this is section 4.6, nature's free stabilization method. And it's been used. Tech Sat 21, they look like giant empty tubes just up in space. So this was used for the Tech Sat 21 satellites. They were planned with the gravity gradient stabilization method in mind. Sometimes gravity gradient, someone thought they were clever and gave it a little symbol and called it G2, G squared. So the idea is for a rigid body in space, the lower parts, the parts closer to the middle of the Earth, the lower parts of the body have a stronger gravitational force than the upper parts, which leads to restoring torque. But then it gets complicated. We've got 3D shapes here. We might say the lower parts are heavier, which is utterly confusing. What's heavier? Yeah. So, right, the force of gravity is what we call, something's heavy or not heavy. This is heavier than up here, so that force will be less. Of course, we're abstracting this as if all the mass is concentrated at the bottom and the top, and it's not. It's throughout, and we're going to have to take that into account. So this force will produce a torque on the body. It's sometimes called the tidal force. And you might wonder, well, why don't we use gravity gradient stabilization for everything, like something up in the air? The torque is really small. It's really small. So it would be dominated by like wind up in the air. But when you're out in space, it's vacuum. So this torque, it could be significant enough that it works. So how does it work? We're going to have to back up and analyze this situation in a careful way. So let's talk about what that gravity gradient torque is. It's good at this point to have an image of an abstract body. So we've got mass elements. We've got an inertial frame. So this would be center of Earth. And then we're using some inertial frame centered to the center of the Earth, fixed relative to the fixed stars. The location to the center of mass is RC, and the location to some point in the body is capital R. Little r represents the vector from the center of mass to the little mass point. So we've got this inertial frame, say, centered at center of Earth, but really it's just sort of the mass of body that you're around. Like people might be working on trying to do gravity gradient torques for satellites around asteroids, in which case it's not centered at the center of the Earth. It's centered at kind of the massive body you care about. But for now, let's think of things about the Earth. So this is, we've got our inertial frame, and I'll just say it's got an origin O, and then, right, the usual N1, N2, N3. We've got inertial vectors, those R and RC, and then the relative vectors, little r. So I'll just note that location, this is location of mass element, dm, with respect to inertial origin, or let's just say origin O. And that's going to be location of the center of mass of the body plus little r. On the mass element, so here's our mass element, there's going to be a force. And because this is gravity, it's going to be going towards the inertial origin here. We'll call this df. It's the differential force of gravity on that element, and dfg is going to be equal to, and now you need to use what you got from orbital mechanics, capital G, gravitational constant, mass of the Earth, mass of our little element, divided by the distance to the center of the Earth squared. There's that negative sign, meaning it's pointing in the negative r divided by magnitude of r. So it's pointing in the negative radial direction. Super. Now we want to know what the gravity gradient torque acting on the spacecraft. It's called gravity gradient because, right, the effect of gravity isn't the same throughout. There's a gradient. And we will call that L sub G. This doesn't mean, well, it means torque due to gravity. And what would it be? We would be doing an integral over the body. So this is the body of R cross dFg, right? And then what's that going to be? We can substitute in what we know for dFg. So it'll be, let's put the minus sign out in front. And this will be R cross, this is the cross product, vector cross product, G, mass of the Earth. If I didn't say it, ME is mass of Earth, or whatever the body is that you're about. And then put magnitude of R raised to the third. We'll write big R up here as RC plus R. And we're integrating over mass elements. I combined these two to make capital R to the third and then wrote big R for the vector part as RC plus little r. And now we turn a crank of math. If we take all the constants outside the integral term, so things that we're not integrating over, I'm going to flip the order of the cross product. So let me first get GME. That could definitely be brought out. I'll have RC cross the integral over the body of little r over big R cubed dm. And then the other term is going to be an R cross R term. It's going to have R cross R, which is going to be zero. R cross R, and then over R cubed. We always like fancy ways of writing zero. Then it drops out. So then we're just left with this term. And in fact, we could bring out RC. So then we're just left with this. So this part just sort of went away. And now we need to rewrite the big R to the third. How are we going to do that? Big R, it contains both RC and little r, remember. R equals RC plus little r. Magnitude of R cubed is actually R squared raised to the 3/2. Magnitude of R squared could also be written as R dotted with R raised to the 3/2. And so this is RC plus little r dotted with RC plus little r, that whole thing to the 3/2. You work out what that dot product is, right? You get RC dotted with RC plus, and you'll pick up 2 RC dotted with little r plus little r dotted with little r raised to the 3/2. Well, this is just magnitude of r. This is just magnitude of RC squared. But then we still have that dot product in between. I'm just going to say that magnitude of RC is RC without the vector stuff. And magnitude of R is R, just to make my life a little bit easier here. So I could write this as, at the end of the day, RC squared plus 2 RC, the vector dotted with little r plus little r squared. And that's all raised to 3/2. What we want is 1 over r cubed. So remember what this was. If we do 1 over r cubed, this is just, right, 1 over r cubed. How will we write it? We could write it as RC squared plus 2 RC dotted with R plus little r squared raised to the negative 3/2 power. Pull out the constant, which is RC. Well, I don't know, constant depends on if this is a circular orbit. Let's just bring this thing out. So if we do RC, it's squared and then raised to the negative 3/2 power. So this is actually going to give us a 1 over RC cubed. we want to do that. So then we have inside this parentheses, it'll be 1 plus 2 RC dotted with R divided by RC squared plus R squared over little RC squared raised to the negative 3/2 power. And now we'll use a Taylor series expansion. I don't know if you've seen this. There's a Taylor series. It's good to know if you have 1 plus epsilon, where epsilon is small, raised to anything, let's say to the n, you need that the magnitude of epsilon is much, much less than 1, which it is. RC is big, on the order of 7 million meters, whereas we're talking about a spacecraft that's on the order of a few meters. So that dot product is going to be really, really small compared to RC squared. And this one is even going to be even smaller. So we might even just neglect that. We'll just say this is pretty much negligible. We just want leading order effects. Anyway, what's this Taylor series expansion? It's that this is 1 plus n times epsilon plus something that's related to the magnitude of epsilon squared, which is really, really small. So in this case, we've got n equals negative 3/2. The thing that's small, we'll just consider it, you know, this. So this is going to be approximately 1 over RC cubed. And now using this, we got 1 minus 3/2 of 2 RC dotted with R for RC squared plus things that are just too small to care about. These cancel. I think we've got enough that we can now plug this in, right? The whole goal is to plug this into our integral up here. And that's where we'll continue next time. And then we'll probably get to the conditions for equilibrium for gravity gradient. That'll be that.